Hey folks, I'm going to do, I'm hoping it's going to be a simple video. It's basically just a question and answer sort of thing. I don't mean a live one. I don't do live videos. That's not a thing I'll ever do. Some questions have been asked, and I'm going to answer them. Mostly they're all the same question, just different ways of asking it about the same thing. So most recently by Jerry. Hi, Jerry. About the technology that I use to film YouTube videos, mostly being the software, hardware, the filming environment, behind the scenes sort of thing. But I figured I'd try to maybe address all of them at once while I'm sitting here painting these thousands of figures that I have to paint for my super diorama since I had nothing else to do. I try to film videos like this when I have rather mundane things to do, like painting figures. I don't have to focus on what I'm doing essentially, and I can just chatter away without too much thought, and I don't fuck up what I'm doing. Like if I'm building like tool clamps on a Tiger tank, or I'm trying to accurize a kit that needs a lot of research and stuff, I can't really make a YouTube video about that while I'm doing that, because I'll screw it up. Unless that YouTube video is specifically about that, then I will. But it's not something I can do while I'm chattering away about stuff that's irrelevant to what I'm trying to do with my hands. So I'm gonna address that. Mostly it's Jerry and another guy named Al, another guy named Kevin. They all ask me questions about what it is I do or use to create the videos. I don't use anything really specifically different than what other people in either scale modeling, what they use, or YouTubers in general. What I use is somewhat similar to a lot of what other YouTubers use. There are differences because my specific needs for what my subject is will obviously determine how I film things, what I use to film them, and my end result. But before I bias you guys by telling you what it is I use, because that's what it'll do, I might try to destroy some of those biases by speaking in general about a few things you should think about before you go out and start shopping for cameras and microphones and all that junk. If you're going to be making a YouTube channel and you're going to be filming YouTube videos, you got to think about a few things before you get started. And I strongly advise not doing what I did, and that's just grab your camera and start filming and then figure it out from there. It might be a good idea to take a little bit of advice and stuff from people who have already done it and maybe made a little bit of success here and there, or at least can give you a bit of advice before you get started, so you don't waste money and you don't waste time, and you have more success quicker, rather than just go out, buy some cheap piece of shit camera or set your crappy phone up and just start jabbering away and hope you're going to make all kinds of money. That's not going to happen. You need to do more than that. So you got to ask a couple of questions, like, what are you going to be filming? Like, what is the purpose of your videos? Do you have one? Excuse me. If you're going to be filming, a wide variety of subjects, you're going to need quite a wide variety of equipment to do that. If you're going to be doing like high volume videos with great production value, you're going to need quite a budget to pay for that. You can go so far from all the way up to like having a film crew, an editing crew, a sound crew, or you can just get a cheap camera, cheap-ish camera, not a junk camera, and not your phone, And you know, a decent microphone and some okay software, and learn how to use them, and then you know, go from there. But like I said, it depends on your subject. Now, I can't go into detail on that because there's so many different things you can do with a YouTube channel when it comes to filming. I could just go on and on and on and be just a 5-hour long video talking about every single subject you can think of. Now, so you gotta base your budget and the equipment that you buy with your budget on the needs you're gonna have for filming. So think about what you're gonna be filming and how you're gonna be filming it and where you're gonna be filming it, and then you set your budget up and the equipment you're gonna need according to that. And you do your research on what equipment is best to do that. And you get a range. You know, what's the best equipment? What's the next best equipment? What's affordable versus usable? What's, you know, complete junk? You know, there's expensive junk and there's usable junk and there's medium ranged stuff out there that's like a fair price for a good quality. You know, so you have to find that stuff for yourself, and you do that through research. Don't just, like I said earlier, don't just go buy some crappy camera or set your phone up, start filming and talking and hope you're gonna be successful, because that's really not the way YouTube works. I mean, there's always a chance you're gonna get lucky, like that lady who made the YouTube video with the Wookiee mask, right? You know, that's always possible. She was a nobody, and then she put on a Wookiee mask and started laughing while wearing a Wookiee mask, and all of a sudden she's fucking rich and famous. You know, or the dumbass videos about what's in my fucking purse, right? I mean, if you want to make pointless videos that serve no purpose for anyone other than the simian quality of humanity, sure, go ahead. You don't need much equipment to film that kind of video. You can do it with a fucking cell phone. But, you know, like I said, it all depends on what you're going to be filming. That'll determine what you buy and how much you spend on it. Now, that being said, the rest of what I'm going to talk about will be purely biased towards filming scale modeling videos. And the same rule applies. You can go all out and spend all kinds of money and buy very fancy cameras, very fancy microphones, and set yourself up to host all kinds of different kinds of videos, like live streaming and how-to videos, and product demonstration videos, and podcasts, and all sorts of stuff. If you want to do all that stuff, and you know, you can do all that. You're going to need pretty decent equipment to do. You're not going to need like wicked ass expensive stuff. That's not necessary, but you're going to need quality, you know, reliable equipment that's going to stay relevant for a period of time and won't be obsolete, you know, 2 years after you bought it. That is something that happens quite a bit. This is one of the reasons why I avoid using cell phones for filming, because frame rates are an issue with cell phones. Transfer rates are an issue with cell phones. The rate at which cell phones come on the market and go off the market and become obsolete, and it's just, that's why I don't like cell phones. That's why I don't recommend using one. And then there's the audio quality versus the quality you get from having a standalone microphone. There's an obvious difference between these things. You know, then there's the professional look. If you film with a cell phone, it just doesn't have that professional look. But mine don't either, right? I mean, you got to understand, I don't have the goals that I'm talking about. The goals that I'm talking about aren't shared by me. I'm talking about, you know, in general. I don't have a goal of making high quality, make millions of dollars fucking videos. That's not my goal and never will be. I don't give a shit about that kind of thing. I'm just giving you advice on, you know, things you can use and think about to help you along the way if that's the kind of shit you want to do. So yeah, it's gonna cost you, but not a fortune. You won't need to spend a fortune, not at least not for scale modeling anyway, which is my concern, right? I recommend for technology anyway, a really good quality camera, either a standalone camera like a Sony Handycam, or a good quality webcam. Now, I lean towards the webcams just because of the convenience factor. Recordability is pretty good for webcams. There's a new webcam that is coming out called the MX Brio that I'm considering getting. It's mostly for doing like live streams and, you know, doing like online meetings and shit like that and everything. But it has a couple of features that are really interesting to me to try for scale modeling. One of them is this detail setting where you can take the camera and point it directly down, and it's really good for filming stuff like on a desktop, like on your desk, if you have like documents and stuff that you want to show, or drawings or something you want to show on a live stream to a bunch of people in a meeting. It's really good for that, and that feature kind of sort of attracted me to it. So it's something I'm looking at. I mean, the camera's not enormously expensive. It is, it's more expensive than the cameras I'm using now. Now, the cameras that I use, I have three of them. I'm only using one at the moment. It's a Logitech 920X. I have two 920Xs, and I have a 920C. Now, they're all pretty much the same, so don't worry too much about if it's a 920Z or 920 Elephant Snot or whatever the fuck. It doesn't make any difference, really. At least not in filming videos for scale modeling. It doesn't really matter. The Logitech 920 is a pretty good and very affordable web camera to get. And I've been using them for a good number of years now. And they've been reliable enough for me that I ended up buying several of them to use for different things. I usually have one or two cameras running at the same time. I don't right now because it's not necessary. And I usually only have one camera over here on the paint bench. On the build bench, I'll have two, but they're movable. I can have a wire that connects them directly to my computer, which is another advantage. And that is like 20 feet long, so I can have the camera almost anywhere in my cave, and it's still connected to my computer. So that's a definite plus, and it doesn't need to be plugged into the wall. It's not doesn't need an electric socket or anything. It just plugs right into the computer. Now, having it plugged right into the computer and not a cell phone that I have to use like a Wi-Fi transfer rate or plug it into some kind of device so I can transfer the video off of it is also a plus, because it's recording from the web camera straight to my computer that's over there. So the file is already on my computer, which is what I use to edit my videos. So I don't have to transfer anything. It's right there. And I edit the video right there and then using the software that I use. So that's also a definite plus for using a webcam. Now, I also use a standalone microphone. I will say that the microphone that's built into the Logitech 920C sucks balls. They're shit. So that's why I got a separate microphone. The microphone quality of the Logitech cameras were yuck. I hated them. So I invested in a better quality microphone. I went through a lot of microphones trying to find one that worked for me. And it took me a number of years before I found a good one. And it worked well enough the first time I bought one that I bought another one, but that happened after I broke the first one. So technically I had three of these microphones, but now I only have two because one broke. It broke because I broke it. It wasn't a quality issue. I dropped it on the fucking floor because I'm an idiot. But anyway, it's called the Blue Snoball is what it is. A lot of web or YouTubers use those. I know Panzermeister 36, he was using one. I don't know if he still uses it or not, but he was using it for a long time. Several other YouTubers, you'll see them sitting on their desk. It just looks like a blue ball, or it just looks like a black ball on a stand. I have mine on a boom, so I can move it around depending on where it is. It's got really good capture quality. It's good for a distance, actually. I can stand a good 4 or 5 feet away from it, and it will still capture my voice quite well. And it captures it in a way that I don't have to do much editing to the sound file, like in the way of corrections. I find all video capture devices and audio capture devices, they don't capture sound well enough that I have to, that I can just leave it without editing it. I find that most of it is kind of somewhat tinny sounding. There's no timbre to it. It just sounds like I'm talking inside of a cardboard box or something. There's this somewhat muffled tinny sound to it. So I have to edit it to remove that thin reedy sound that it tends to have. But that only takes like a moment for me to do it on the software that I have, right? So it's not a big deal for me to do it. And I've been doing it for years, so I'm used to it. It's no big deal for me. So I use the blue ball, the blue balls. I've got blue balls. So I use the Snoball Blue, or Blue Snoball microphone. I'm flashing up, links or images of these devices. And there's links to the Amazon Canada if you're in Canada, you'd use the Amazon link that I put in the video description. But don't buy it if you're not in Canada. Don't buy it from there. Just it gives you more details on it. And that's not what I'll do. Actually, if you've already clicked on it, you already know what I'm going to do. I just put links to the actual manufacturer's sites. So. Anyway, by the time you guys are watching this 5 years from now, these things will all be discontinued and they'll all have new shit. So anyway, so that's what I use for the microphone. And that's basically it. So I usually have two of the webcams running at the same time, and I have one of the microphones running at the same time. These are all plugged into my computer, and I do all my editing on my computer. I strongly advise, if you're going to be making moderately quality YouTube videos that you're looking to maybe make some money off of, get yourself a computer, a decent one. Doesn't have to be like an incredibly expensive one. It can be just one that can run a little bit of video. Doesn't have to be, even a cheap gaming computer will do it. Like a cheap one, like a $300 or $400 gaming computer. That's Canadian money, by the way. Will crunch video. So you don't need anything ridiculously expensive. I can't recommend Mac or anything like that because I don't use those things. I fucking hate Mac. I had one for a while, but it was kind of like trying to drive a car with my feet. I couldn't get my head around the damn thing. I hate the way Mac organizes information. It's almost like a person with a brain tumor designed the thing. Oh wait, I think he did. I think he did have a brain tumor, but either way, it's just the way the Macs are set up is not the way my brain works, so I can't fucking operate them. Now, I do like their mobile devices, their iPads, I like them, but again, I hate the way they organize photos. It's fucking insane. They don't, actually, until recently. Yeah, they just recently allowed it so that you could find a way to organize them. But that's only a recent thing. I think after people complained and bitched and moaned. It's like they just don't understand what a file structure is for. But anyway. Yeah, so get yourself a computer. Don't try using a mobile device to edit your videos. They look extremely amateurish when you do that. Lots of people do it. I'm not saying you can't do it. I'm just saying it just doesn't look good. You can tell the difference when somebody has been making YouTube videos on their phone. Oh, that's the other thing. This is a big pet peeve of mine. When you're filming video and taking pictures, do it this way. Landscape. Don't ever film YouTube videos like this, because YouTube is widescreen. It's a widescreen video platform, okay? TikTok and fucking Instagram are phone savvy shit, okay? But YouTube is this way. Film your videos this way. Take your pictures this way. And if you don't like the shape of them, you can crop them later. But there's nothing I hate more than looking at a photo on anything and these two big black bars are on either side of it. It just looks so unprofessional when you do that. It's really it's a big pet peeve of mine when I see that. Same thing in like instant messaging and stuff. Like, I got friends all over the world that do it all the time because everybody I know has a fucking cell phone and they all live in the cell phone world, and I don't. I'm one of those guys that don't live in a cell phone world. I mean, it's so bad for me. I mean, this is an iPhone 14, but there's no SIM card in it, and I've never put a SIM card in it, and I never will. So it's an iPod, and that's the way I use it. I don't need a cell phone. I only need something that connects to Wi-Fi every now and again, because I bought it for the camera, and it's a camera that has all kinds of fancy things, like connects to my email and shit like that and everything when I'm in a Wi-Fi environment. I don't ever need to talk to somebody when I'm not in my house. It never happens. If I get struck by lightning or attacked by coyotes when I'm walking my dog, well, it's just my fucking time to die. And I just fucking do it like an animal's supposed to. I don't fucking bitch and moan on the fucking phone and say, oh my God, my legs are falling up because a coyote's chewing my balls. Oh God, send EMS to save my ass. No, I just die like I'm supposed to. There's 8 billion of us. Nobody fucking needs me. Anyway, that was a bit of a rant, wasn't it? So anyway, I don't have that mindset of cell phone world. So I don't, when I'm out taking pictures or something like that, like when I'm out walking the dog, I don't hold my phone like this. I never hold my phone like this unless I'm reading something. If I want to take a picture, I always turn my phone and take pictures this way. Always. I've always done it that way because that's, I used to, one of my hobbies years and years ago was photography, and I rarely tipped the camera on its side to take a picture unless I was taking a picture of a person's face and it was up close. That's really the only, or a small subject and it was up close and I needed to get the camera in like nice and tight. It was very rare I ever turned the camera on its side. It just, I preferred the widescreen all the time. And every piece of technology I had, right up until now, that I used to edit for photos and videos, it's all widescreen. I don't know. I'm weird, I guess. I just don't get that whole portrait mode for everything that everybody does. It's like skinny pants. Like the fucking fashion that's out there now where all these guys are wearing, walking around wearing clothes that look like they belong to their skinny little brother. They got all these little weird, tight little pants and high cuffs on their pants. Like they're wearing their like clothes they got at the used clothing store. They look like they don't fit. I don't get that either. I mean, I'm the kind of guy who wears tactical. My motto is tactical is practical, actually. All I wear is tactical pants and tactical shirts and tactical jackets and boots. So it's, yeah, like I said, I'm fucking weird. So when it comes to getting equipment and stuff for videos and everything, I tend to be also very practical, very stuck in my way, I guess. But that doesn't mean I'm not open to change, because I am. Like I was talking earlier about that new Logitech camera with the new look down feature. So I'm always looking at new technology to see if it's pertinent and effective for what it is that I do. And you should do the same when you're looking for equipment. You should, again, what are you going to be filming? And you get the equipment that's going to best enable you to film what you're going to be demonstrating or showing or talking about on YouTube. So that's the microphone and the cameras that I use. Now, the software that I use to edit my videos is pretty simple. I've been using the same software since... trying to remember now. Probably 2014. It is, because it's called PowerDirector 2014. PowerDirector 2014 is the name of the software that I use, because that's when I bought it. I did have one that was older than that, and it was also made by PowerDirector, but I upgraded it. I was using an older one in 2014. So I've got PowerDirector 2014. I've stopped upgrading it because they don't support it anymore. PowerDirector now, it's owned by CyberLink, I think is the name of the company. They've now switched over from you buy the software and you have the software, and then every now and again they release an update for it. They don't do that anymore. It's now a subscription service like Microsoft Office is. And I am not the kind of person that falls into that scam. I will never, ever own subscription-based software like that. Like, other than like virus protection, I'm not stupid enough to buy software like that. If it's a no-go, if there's no other form of that software out there, I just stop using it altogether and give up on it. That's it. But so the PowerDirector 14 is the one I've been using for ages and ages. I'm very happy with it. It's very easy to use, and I have no intention of changing it because there's no need. Eventually, I'm certain it will no longer function on the computers as I slowly upgrade computers over the years. It'll come a time where it no longer works on the computer. The computer won't support it anymore. I mean, I'm sure that'll happen. and I'll have to find some other way to do things, but I'm hoping I'll be dead before that happens. That'd be nice. But until then, that's what I use. Now, there are alternatives. There is one called DaVinci that's free, and it is very, very, very similar to PowerDirector. I've tried it, and there really isn't a lot of difference between DaVinci and PowerDirector. It actually has some features that PowerDirector doesn't have. And you can buy a paid-for version of DaVinci. At least you could the last time I looked at it. Now, I haven't looked at it in a long time, so they may have switched over to a subscription service now, which is bogus. I can't really speak to it, but the original or the older versions of DaVinci were definitely something worth looking at. There's a couple other ones that are out there that are pretty similar, but I don't know what they're called. I never really looked at them. But there are several free-to-use platforms you can use for editing video. And they're very easy to use, for the most part. I know PowerDirector is. Otherwise, I wouldn't use it. I'm one of those guys that the simplest technology is the best technology. I don't need it to be overcomplicated with jargon, and I don't need to take a course in engineering in order to make it work. If I can manage to pull that off, then yay. That's why I use an Apple phone rather than an Android phone. I tried Android, and oh my fucking Christ. I've never seen such a badly designed piece of technology. An Apple phone, a dead chimpanzee with no thumbs and his asshole in his forehead could figure out how to use an Apple phone. Not so much with an Android phone. You need to have a lot more know-how and savvy and patience to use one of those. My wife had one for actually a really long time. She had one until we finally just said, you know what, this thing is just making you a very angry person. So we got rid of it, switched to an Apple phone, and she was like, where the fuck has this thing been all my life? She couldn't believe the difference between the two phones. And she said she'll never go back. The only downside with the Apple phones is they're fucking outrageously expensive. That's the problem with that. Now, my wife does own a cellular phone with a cellular phone package, but she almost never fucking uses the thing. I can't call her on it because she never has it turned on. She only uses it for emergencies. But she does use it for when she's in the house. She uses the Wi-Fi for surfing the web and all that stuff and everything. So that's about as far as she goes with cellular phones. And she has even less patience for technology than I do. So that rule of simple and easy with no jargon works even more so for her. So, so if you're shopping and you're an old guy like me in your 50s, you don't have a lot of patience for how clever people who design technology are getting, then you want nice and simple and easy to use. Something like PowerDirector was pretty friggin' simple and easy for an idiot like me to use. And the Logitech cameras were pretty easy and simple for me to use. They're literally plug and play. Same with that Snoball microphone. You plug it in, it works. Didn't have to do any setup whatsoever. You got to have to, in order for your video to be captured by your computer, you need a video capture software. Now, PowerDirector has capture ability. You can turn on PowerDirector and then record directly to PowerDirector. I've actually never done that. I could try it someday, but I've actually never done it. The only reason I haven't is because I have always used Logitech software to do it. I use a piece of software that Logitech has created called Logicapture. L-O-G-I Capture. And it's free, and you can download it from their website anytime that you want. It's what I'm using right now. You can put a watermark, like what's right here. All my videos are watermarked, and I started putting that watermark on there because I kept finding my videos on some of Rush's video sharing platforms. People were downloading my videos and then re-uploading them with their name on it. I found several of my videos over there doing that. I was like, oh, well, it's nice to be popular, but I'm not really cool with that. You can do that, just make sure my name's on it. So I put my name on all my videos now, just to, I guess, not so much claim that piece of fame, but make sure that people aren't saying things that aren't true. So I'm not really a big defender of intellectual property. It's not really a thing for me, but I don't like liars very much. And downloading something that doesn't belong to you and then reposting it, that's a thing that will probably piss me off a bit. So, but anyway, so I use Logicapture to capture the video. How that works is you plug your camera and your phone, or camera and your microphone, into your computer. Both connect with USB connections. And then you open Logicapture, and it automatically detects your cameras, and you can select, like I have multiple cameras connected to my computer, so I tell it which camera to use. And you can even tell it to have camera in camera, so it's actually hardwired, so I can actually have another, like right here, I can have a little screen with another camera angle, or up here I can have one, I can have several cameras. I can split the camera in half, the screen in half, so one shot's on one side, one shot's on the other. So there's all kinds of things I can do with the Logicapture. It's actually pretty cool. There's a bunch of special effects I can add over on the side of the menu, and it's pretty simple and easy to use. not a whole lot of jargon and stuff that I don't understand. It's written in simple language. So so that's basically it. Now I was gonna do a behind the scenes sort of shot video to show you what it looks like when I'm sitting here doing this, when I'm filming video, but I, in all fairness, I didn't really see the point. I have a camera here. I mean, my cave looks like my cave. It's a rectangular room. One side of it is covered in shelves. Actually, one side and both ends are covered in shelves with my models on them. You guys have seen pictures of my cave on my Facebook page. All right, and then this whole side along this wall is nothing but my workbenches. I have a build bench over there. I have this centerpiece here where my computers are. That's where I edit videos. And then I have this station here for painting. This station is a total mess right now because of the super diorama. Normally it's much more neat. I don't have all this crap that you see here. All this stuff is usually put away. It's just I'm painting figures, like lots of figures. I don't know. You guys can't see them, but I'm painting all those. All right, and there's more behind me. There's more back there. You can see them. I moved the light other way. There's more there. There's about 100 figures all told that I'm trying to paint. So, so the behind the scenes is just a fat old bald guy sitting in a room surrounded by junk and cameras. So it's really not, there's no like, you know, Easter eggs or funny people doing tricks and stuff like that. So there's really not much to see for the behind the scenes. I've got, you know, a camera on a boom. That's what this is. And then I have my microphone right there. It's on a boom. And by boom, I mean, it's like the booms you use to put desk lamps on, those, you know, telescopic arms. And that's about it, right? You can buy those on Amazon, the booms. So that's about it. There's really not much else I can tell you. You investigate what it is you're going to be filming, and then research what equipment is best going to meet the needs that you're going to have, and then research what is best of that equipment for affordability, ratings, features. Buy it. And then learn how to use it very well. Like, learn how to use your cameras, learn how to use your microphone, placement, lighting. Lighting is also important. I should probably get to that. Yeah. Learn how to use it all. Placement, how to film things. What's the best way to place your equipment to get the best quality and angle to demonstrate what it is you're trying to do. You learn how to do all this before you start actually posting anything to YouTube. And the reason why you do that is very simple. If you just grab your cell phone, make a couple of rinky-dinky silly videos that are I'm gonna start making YouTube videos. Oh, film a video of something stupid. Like I did. I filmed 12 videos in a row of me sitting at my bench building a Bandai Millennium Falcon. No, it was a Fine Molds Millennium Falcon in 1/44 scale. 12 videos of me just sitting at the bench, listening to the radio, and I never said a word for 12 videos straight. Now, I can't tell you how many subscribers I did not get or potentially lost and never got back again because I did that. That was a really stupid thing for me to do. And the reason why I did is because I was chicken shit. I was too much of a coward to practice. It didn't even occur to me to do it. To practice filming, practice talking, you know, how to set up, what to talk about, make some notes. Like I have some notes right here about what to talk about in this video, right? It never even occurred to me back then to do it. And I probably lost a solid subscriber base on the first day that I posted any videos. Now, you don't want to start off like that, right? You want to start off on a good foot. So your first video is a really good, right out of the gate kind of thing. So set yourself up for success right away. So practice for a little bit on using your equipment. Practice how to speak. Listen to how you sound and play with the sound on with your software. Get the feel that you want. You're going to want to set up a feel, right? People expect an atmosphere that reoccurs in your videos. They become nostalgic about it, believe it or not. There's actually people that say to me, you know, I've been watching your videos for 10 years and blah, blah, blah. I love this and I love that. And you've been doing this for this long. And it just becomes part of the experience when they watch your videos. And they become quite attached to sounds and appearances and placement of tools and the way the light is. If you even change the light in your videos so things are more harsh or they're more soft and stuff like that, you believe it or not, you can lose subscribers just from something simple like that. You change the way your voice sounds and stuff like that, you can lose subscribers just by doing that. Don't upload more than one or two videos in one day. Don't ever do that. That's not a good thing to do. I've done that and I lost 2,500 subscribers in a single day. I even made a video saying, "Hi guys, I'm going to be uploading a whole bunch of videos." Like, and I even said how many there were. I think it was like 112 videos. I'm going to be uploading like 112 videos to rebuild my channel. So you might want to unsubscribe from my channel for a few days until I rebuild it, because I can't tell YouTube not to tell you about it. And back then, that was the way it was. I couldn't. It was very difficult for me to just upload and then not publish right away. It was just easier to publish them right away as soon as I uploaded them. They've changed that. They've made it a lot better now. But so I can upload like 150 videos all at once and then just release one or two a day if I wanted to. But back then it was a bit more cumbersome to do it. So I uploaded all those videos at once and I lost 2,500 subscribers in a single day. And I never got them back. So yeah, don't do that. Upload one or two videos a day and upload your videos on Friday or Saturday. That's the best time to do any kind of video post. Uploading videos in the middle of the week and you're not going to get all that much traffic. But if you don't care about that kind of thing, it doesn't make any difference. You can post your videos whenever you want. I'm retired, so I'm home all the time, so I watch YouTube videos whenever I feel like watching YouTube videos. It doesn't matter what day of the week it is, but the vast majority of people, that's not the way it works. And I tend to post videos somewhat randomly, but it depends. I do put some thought into, you know, what's going on this week. Is is there a football game on in the United States? Is there a holiday in Europe? Is there, you know, I do think about that sometimes, because I've had certain videos I actually want to get some traction, and the other videos I don't really give a fuck about. This would be one I don't give a fuck about. So I do put some thought now and again, just not very often. So depending on how much success you're looking for and what you want out of your channel, that's something you need to do too. Lighting. That was the other thing I wanted to talk about. It's important to have really good quality lighting for most of your subjects. Now, it depends on what you're filming, the kind of lights you want to get. There's all kinds of different kinds of lights you can get. Some of them are expensive. Some of them, they're pretty cheap. When it comes to lights, it depends on what you want. You can get what you pay for some of them, and some of them you actually get a pretty good deal for what you pay for. They're not all just junk. So what I tend to use, I don't buy like studio lights or anything like that because they're too big. There are, like, I know Ian White, CW Modeling, for some of his stuff, he uses big, like, they're like what I call studio lights. They're for mostly for photography. They're the big, huge clamshell-shaped lights and stuff like that. They're really good for photography and for filming subjects and stuff like that that need a lot of focus. And like close-in subjects and stuff like that. They're really good for that sort of thing. So if you're going to be doing that kind of thing on a regular basis, absolutely, I recommend getting those. They're not really expensive. And you really only need to buy them one time because you're not going to be using them all the time. And when you do, you're only going to be using them for, I don't know, 45 minutes or so at a time. It's not like you're going to turn them on to do like actual normal bench work where you're sitting there for 2 or 3 hours working on a subject. You're only going to use them when you're filming. And so, you know, they'll last a really long time. For lights like in your cave that you're going to be using, again, that's specific to where you're going to be filming and how. If you're filming like at a kitchen table or a coffee table, or you're out in your garage or something that you don't have a permanent workspace for building your models, that makes things a bit more tricky because you need something that's portable. But there's lots of options for that, and they're good ones. Where is it? I don't know if you can see it or not. This light that I'm using, right, see if I can get it in the camera without knocking everything over. This thing here is a pretty decent one. It folds out like this. It's LED, poses like this. It's quite bright. It's on a boom, so it can go up and down. It has a button that you can set the color, the tone. So you can change it from yellow, that weird yellow incandescent color that, you know, old-fashioned light bulbs have, or daylight, which is what I always use and what I recommend for filming everything, is use daylight colors. You can use like soft colors. You can make it brighter, you can make it dimmer. So it's a pretty good quality for what it is. I'm showing pictures of it actually as I'm talking, so you can actually see the damn thing. So that is simple. It's portable. It just clamps to your desk or table or coffee table. I use it quite a lot actually. It's because it's so versatile. But I also use this one here that I have here. This is from Lee Valley. I use it for painting figures and doing close-up stuff because my eyes are shit, but it's also good for general purpose light too. And for a very long time, I filmed all of my videos using two of these things suspended over my bench. They're very bright, they last a really, really long time. They're very poseable. The magnifier is enormous. Like I can get my face right in there, and you know, it does my body good. I don't have to hunch over it or anything like that, which is terrible for my back. So it's daylight, so it's a nice white, like a blue white light. So that's what you want for filming and taking pictures. You don't want to use yellow lights like, you know, in your house, a regular house light, incandescent lights. That's not what you want to use because it screws up the color of your models. And also for filming. So you don't want to do that. You want to use daylight. Daylight bulbs. Actually, if you don't know what that is, just type in daylight bulbs when you're searching for stuff on Google. And you'll see what I'm talking about. I also use, now these are suspended over my bench, these are garage lights. They're big long tubes. They look like fluorescent tubes, but they're LEDs. And I use those. They're suspended over my benches. And that's primarily what I use most of the time for almost all of my work. It's only when I'm doing like close-up figure painting that I use these lights on booms. But for general purpose work, I only turn on the overheads because that's all I need. They're very bright and they give very little shadow because they have quite a bit of diffusion and makes it easy for me to see. They don't get hot And they're also quite cheap, which is also good because I'm a cheap son of a bitch. So yeah, so lighting is important, and you have several different options to choose from for depending on your needs and your space and what you're going to be doing with your videos. So I guess that's it. Lecture over. Now I could demonstrate how to use the software and stuff like that, but I don't know if I can do that in a way that would make any sense, because I barely know how to use it and I only use it for what I use it for. There's probably thousands and thousands of different things you could do with the software I use to make my videos that I didn't even know it did. But I don't need to know that it does it because I don't give a shit. If I did a segment of this video showing you how I use the software, I would accidentally create that bias for you. So if you're going to use any of the software I suggest you figure it out. You learn how to use it, and you probably get better at it than I am, for sure. Especially if you're young. You probably have more patience for it than I do. You'll have more success than I do when it comes to that. So I think that's about it. I don't have anything else that I can really show you or talk to you about. That's all I use. I don't really have any hidden gems or anything that I can think of. My filming environment in here is specifically designed for me to film videos. When I designed this cave, I built it myself. I had my filming needs in mind when I built it. So, I have frames sticking out of the wall and stuff for me to be able to bolt cameras to and stuff like that, and microphones. So, if you have the option to be able to do that yourself, then you really need to put thought into that. But if you're going to be doing things in a simpler fashion, like you're using a pre-existing space, like a bedroom, a spare bedroom, or an office, or a garage, or you're at the kitchen table, or the dining room table, or a coffee table. That's where I worked for years and years and years, actually, at a dining room table. Then you're going to have to be more efficient with your use of space and use of equipment, and all your stuff is going to have to be a lot more portable. But a webcam is very small, a laptop is very small, the camera that I suggested is very small as well. It's about the size of a softball. It's not that difficult to use all of these things even in a small environment. It's all very possible and plausible. I think that's about it. I don't think I have anything else I could say. Anyway, so if you're going to be making your own videos and making scale modeling videos, I'll look forward to seeing them. So, good luck. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.